מזל טוב, תודה חתן and כלה and to the whole family. ברוך השם, I'm happy to see you in your happy day. שבע ברכות. You should know the happy time of the חתן and כלה, it's 1 year. נקי יהיה לביתו לשנה. 1 year you have to take care of your wife, make her happy, don't bring too many guests to the house. You have to give her a lot of attention. It helps to build a better future, Be'ezrat Hashem. And of course, the wife has to treat her husband like a king. And, you know, that has to be the first thing in her life. The Torah say that Hashem look at Adam. Adam was just created. He was alone. There was no women in the world. And Hashem said in the Torah, Lo tov eyot Adam levado. It's not good for a man to be alone. He must have a woman with him. Without a woman, he's incomplete. Eselo ezer kenegdo. I'm going to make him a partner. Who's the partner? The woman. But why God did not make the woman from scratch, just like he made the man? Why did he have to take from the DNA of the man, from the rib, and make the woman? To remind the women that the only reason they came to the world is to help the men, not to become the boss, like today in America. Feminism. Every woman wants to be the president of the United States. The way it used to be in Bukhara. Okay, now, but it doesn't mean that you don't have to respect the women like queens, and treat them the nicest way. The Torah say, Ve'azav et avi ve'imo ve'davak be'ishto. Once you join together with your wife, you put her on the top before even the parents. Ve'azav et avi ve'imo ve'davak be'ishto. A man leaves the house of his parents. I don't care you eat, but just please don't make noise.
Yes.
He leaves his father and mother, and now he moves and becomes one with his wife. The Kabbalah teach that before the person come to the world, it was one soul. And then it splits to two. And it goes to two different bodies. One to a man, and one to a woman. When they go under the chuppah, once he put the ring on her finger and say to her, Areat mekudeshet li, those two halves connect together and become one. That's why that sometimes when people, lo aleinu, God forbid, when they get divorced, the Torah says he has to give her a get in her hand to cut between the souls. If they separate 10 years, he lives here and she lives in a different country and they have no connection, the souls still connect. If someone touched her, it's death penalty in the Torah. Why? What do you mean? I'm not with my husband for 10 years. It doesn't matter. As long as he did not get, chas v'shalom, the get, the souls are connected forever. That's what a lot of people don't understand. They say, oh, I already left my husband 3 years ago. You can never leave him until you receive chas v'shalom, they get in the hand, and everybody should know the importance of the connection to the souls. Now, because we are just before Rosh Hashanah, we are now Thursday, in 3 days it's going to be Rosh Hashanah. The sad news is that maybe 80% of the Jewish people in the world do not even know what Rosh Hashanah means. If you stand in Tel Aviv, and you ask 100,000 Israelis from Tel Aviv, excuse me, Itzik, excuse me, Avi, excuse me, Moshe, excuse me, all day. What does it mean, Rosh Hashanah? The Israelis will tell you, a new year, a beginning of a new year, according to Judaism. But that's all they know. They don't know anything about Rosh Hashanah. You ask them, what's so special about the New Year? I don't know. A New Year, we make a party and we go to the beach. Or we go on a picnic to the Kinneret. But what does it mean, Rosh Hashanah? Nobody knows. There is a big problem today among the Jewish people. And also here in a room, also right here. 50 years ago, all the Jewish people knew what Rosh Hashanah means. Today, almost nobody knows. Now we had an election in Israel. Half of the people in Israel, half, meaning 3 million people, voted to destroy the Torah, to eliminate Hashem, not to put religion in Israel. Half of the people in Israel, all they spoke about in the election, help us to close the yeshivot, help us to cancel Shabbat, help us to fight the religious people, help us to make Jews marry non-Jews, help us to marry men with men, help us to marry women with women, help us to cancel religion. Half of the people in Israel, Bukharians, Persians, Moroccans, Iraqis, Ashkenazim, half of the people in Israel vote for people that say, I want to be the new Greeks, like Antiochus. I want to destroy the Torah. I want to destroy Shabbat. I want to destroy Brit Milah. Why so many Israelis hate God and the Torah so much? Is it because they are very bad people? No. Is it because they are evil? No. The answer is because not once in their life, not even one time in their life, they never read the Torah. Who over here in the room, and over here there are people who are more close to religion, who here in a room can raise his hand and tell me that he read the Torah once in his life from the beginning to the end and understand all the meanings of all the words? Forget about the secrets. Forget about Rashi. Forget about Kabbalah. Forget about Midrashim, forget about Gemara. I'm not even going into yeshiva stuff. I'm talking first grade in yeshiva, right here in Queens. Yeah. First grade, 6 years old, little children. You ask them, tell me the meaning of all the words of the Torah. You don't have one secular Jew in the world that read the Torah one time in his life. So how is it possible that half of the Chilonim, half of the secular people in Israel, hate religion so much when they don't even know what it is? It's hard to believe. I give you an example. If I come and I give you now a speech against Shakespeare, I speak 2 hours against Shakespeare. It's crazy, he's meshuga, he's stupid, his books are stupid. Then one of you get up and ask me, excuse me, sir, you've been speaking 2 hours against Shakespeare, you hate him very much, and you don't like his books. Can you tell me, please, which book of Shakespeare you read in your life? And I answer, I never read any book of Shakespeare. Then you would tell me, you're the most stupid person in history. You're speaking 2 hours against Shakespeare, you want to burn his books, you say he's crazy, and you don't know one word from his book. Does it make sense to you or no? Make sense or no? What do you think?
No.
So how come 3 million Israelis and another 3 or 4 million Americans every day of their life attack the Torah, attack Judaism, attack Shabbat, and they don't even know what it means? I want to ask you another question. Who here can raise his hand and tell me, what does it mean to keep Shabbat? What does it mean, Shabbat? You hear Shabbat. Religious people don't drive the car on Shabbat. They go to the synagogue. They close their business. But who can tell me what Shabbat means? Nobody knows. Nobody knows what Shabbat is. People fight Shabbat, but they don't know what it is. Who can raise his hand here and tell me, according to God, what does it mean, Shabbat? What Shabbat means? If you think Shabbat is a day of rest, meaning you work too hard during the week and Shabbat you have to sleep, you are wrong. Because even a king that sleeps all week, a king that sleeps all week and do nothing, he still have to keep Shabbat. It has nothing to do with work. I'll give you another example. In Shabbat, if you serve as a waiter in Brit Milah, in a synagogue, you work very hard, you have 500 people, you serve, you pick up the plates, you move tables, you clean, you wash dishes, you bring dessert. All day you work, you did not break Shabbat. One time you turn the lights on, you break Shabbat. So it's nothing to do with hard work. It's nothing to do with work. What does it mean Shabbat? Who knows? The answer is nobody knows. People fight against Shabbat. They are afraid to keep Shabbat, and they don't know what Shabbat means. Now I'm going to give you the shock of your life. This lecture will not be long. I'm only giving you a few things to think about before the judgment day. Rosh Hashanah is the judgment day of every person in the world, Jews and non-Jews. The whole world is being judged. What's going to happen to us next year? Are we going to be healthy? Are we going to make money? Are we going to get married? Are we going to have children? Are we going to be happy? Everything is going to be decided Sunday night. Sunday night, Monday night, for 2 days. That's the judgment day of every Jew. Now I want to explain to you what Shabbat means. Shabbat, it's the agreement between God and the Jewish people that if you want to be my son or my daughter and you want to be belong to my nation, condition number one, you need your mother to be Jewish. If your mother is Jewish, you are Jewish. If your mother is not Jewish, you cannot be Jewish. This one, everyone knows. If your mother is Jewish, you are Jewish. But the second condition, nobody knows. Who knows what's the second condition to be Jewish? That without it, you are considered like a non-Jew in the Torah. Who knows what's the second condition? What's the second condition? If you are Shomer Shabbat, you are 100% a Jew. If you're not Shomer Shabbat, it's written in the Torah, you are 100% a Goy. You cannot be even be buried in a Jewish cemetery. That's what the Torah say. And most Jews do not know it. How many Jews know it? If I say Kiddush on Shabbat, I take a wine, $20,000 bottle. Very expensive, 100-year-old bottle. I spill the wine into my cup. And one person that is not Shomer Shabbat, move it like this, I must spill it to the garbage. I cannot do Kiddush on the wine. The wine is not kosher anymore. Why? Because the same way that a non-Jew touched the wine, if someone that is not Shomer Shabbat touched the wine is not kosher. If someone that is not Shomer Shabbat was a witness in your wedding, you are not married because you need two Jews to be witness. If one of them was Mechalel Shabbat, you're not considered married. If you're going to have children, the children are children out of the marriage, like a boyfriend and girlfriend. What do you mean? I had a wedding. It doesn't matter. One of the witnesses was not Shomer Shabbat. You're not considered to be Jewish. If a non-Shomer Shabbat made Kiddush for the family, it's like not counting. Everybody has to do Kiddush for himself. Not Shomer Shabbat cannot do Kiddush for the family. If a Mechalel Shabbat cook, you're not allowed to eat from the food. If Mechalel Shabbat take a loan, if a Jew, if you charge interest from a Jew, you have no share to the world to come and you don't get up in the resurrection of the dead. When Mashiach come, Hashem will bring back all the dead people to life. But someone that was taking interest from another Jew is not getting up. But if that Jew was Mechalel Shabbat, no problem. Because the Torah says you're allowed to take interest from the Goyim. And someone that is not Shomer Shabbat is 100% a Goy. If he dies, if Mechalel Shabbat died, you cannot bury him in a Jewish cemetery. You have to bury him in the side of the Goyim. My father just passed 7 months ago, 7 months in Israel. in Rehovot, Motzei Shabbat, we got a call. That's it. My father was sick. Saturday night, they called us. He passed already. The funeral will be on Sunday. Of course, I could not go to sleep that night. We were looking for a flight to go to Israel. Then my brother-in-law called me Sunday morning in Israel. By us, it was in the middle of the night. He told me, you're not going to believe it. They do not want to bury your father in a Jewish cemetery. They want to bury him in the side of the Goyim. I asked why. My father was Shomer Shabbat for 20 years. They say you have to bring a letter from the rabbi of the synagogue that knew that it's Shomer Shabbat. Baruch Hashem, I called the rabbi and we took care of it. But if I could not bring proof that it was Shomer Shabbat, they bury him with Ahmed and Mustafa and Vladimir and all the Goyim.
Uliano.
You understand? Now I want to tell you something else. In Monsi, there is a religious cemetery. One time, one kid died from drugs, 21 years old. Died from drugs, from overdose. The funeral was Friday afternoon. It was raining. We had to go to the cemetery. When we were there in front of the grave of that boy, I saw a family of Russian people, not religious. They don't look Jewish, Bichlal. They asked, can you come to say Kaddish with us? I said, I wonder what these people doing in this religious cemetery. It's all Hasidim over here. Then I realized they have a section for people that are not Shomer Shabbat. This boy, the drug addict, was not Shomer Shabbat. They bury him in a section of the Goyim. This is the truth, Rabotai. Now the question is, who here wants to raise his hand and tell me, I don't mind to be like a goy in the eyes of God. That when I die, I stand in front of God and will tell me, shame on you. I gave you oxygen, I gave you water, I gave you food, I gave you a house, I gave you wife and children, I gave you money, I gave you health, everything I gave you, you took from me and you used it against me. Who wants to one day to stand in front of God and get the shock of his life? The answer, nobody wants. So I would like to finish with one thing. One thing. If you are honest, you don't have to listen to me, you don't have to believe me. I'm a very, very straight person. If I say something, it's 1,000,000%. I don't say something unless I have a source. But because we are now in the middle of a party, I don't want to go too far. I brought you CDs over here, free. I want each one of you to take these CDs and please watch them and you see all the sources. You're going to see a proof that God exists. You're going to see a proof that the Torah, it can never be written by human being. It can only be written by the creator of the world. You're going to see what it means to be Mechalel Shabbat. You're going to see why we have so many problems in our life. Don't you want the problems to go away? You're going to see how to raise children. You're going to see how to be happy in a marriage. You're going to see how to be successful in a business. You're going to see how to have blessing in children and babies and everything in your life. You're going to see how to get a good wife or a good husband. You're going to see a treasure. Treasure of information. But the point is like this, Rabotai. Many of you here in the room are not Shomer Shabbat. Not because you bad people. I'm sure if there was a problem and I would come and tell you, come help me, you would spend the whole night helping me. Even if you're not Shomer Shabbat. I'm sure if I tell you there's a poor family who do not have money for Rosh Hashanah to eat, each one of you would put a lot of money on the table. I'm sure you have a heart. I know Bukharian people. Every Bukharian I met in the last 25 years has a heart of gold. Sometimes he gets angry, sometimes he has ego, but in the foundation, they have a heart of gold. Now the question is, if you're nice to the whole world, isn't it right that you be nice to the one that gives you everything? How do you take everything from him and use it against him? Your grandparents in Uzbekistan and Bukhara, they would die not to be Mechalel Shabbat. They would die not to be Mechalel Shabbat. If they tell your grandmother, come, light the fire on Shabbat, we'll give you, I don't know, $1,000. She'll look at you like you're crazy. I'll die and I will not start the fire on Shabbat. What happened in two generations that half of the people became like goyim? I will finish with one story. I will finish with 1 minute story with your permission, and then we'll continue, Baruch Hashem, the dinner. One story for you to understand. The story is like this. In the Holocaust, Yimach Shimam, the Nazis, they used to bring Jews into the court and trial them on Shabbat. On Shabbat. It was a show for them. They used to put a Jew to write the protocol. They put the judge as a Jew. All the people that come are all Jews. And the people that sit in the audience were all Nazi soldiers. So they brought an old woman. They blame her that she took a piece of bread and she threw it to someone in a camp. She sits in a court and they ask her, did you throw a piece of bread to that prisoner? And she doesn't answer. They ask her 5 times, ma'am, did you throw the piece of bread to the person inside the camp? She doesn't answer. Her son is sitting in the audience. He begins to scream, mom, you were not there. There are witnesses over here that it's not you. Please answer. She doesn't answer. The Nazi said to the Jewish judge, ask her one last time. Shh. Another half a minute. Ask her one last time. One last time. If she doesn't answer, death penalty. The Jewish judge, asked her, ma'am, did you throw bread to the person inside the camp? It's the last time I ask you. Please answer. She doesn't answer. The judge say, death penalty. When they take the woman outside, her son told her, why didn't you answer? It wasn't you. You're not supposed to give up on life. You know what she answered to her son? This is a lesson to each one of us 48 hours before the judgment day. She told her son, don't be stupid. If I would answer, the Jewish guy will have to write on Shabbat. How can I agree to something like this? That a Jew would lose his share to the world to come because he writes on Shabbat. Because the Torah say, this is what we say when we do Kiddush, and I'm sure many of you say Kiddush, Veshamru bnei Israel et Shabbat. The nation of Israel observed the Sabbath. La'asot et ha-Shabbat ledorotam brit olam. To make Shabbat an eternal agreement for their generations. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity. Between me, who is speaking here? God. Between me and the Jewish children, it's a sign for eternity that I made the world in 6 days. And in a 7 day I rested. Everyone that will break Shabbat will be put to death in this life and in the next life, and his soul will be cut permanently from the eternal life. It's a verse in the Torah. I did not write the Torah. Again, I love each one of you. That's why I came to wake you up 2 days before the judgment day. It's still not too late. Tomorrow there is Shabbat, tomorrow night. You can still keep the last Shabbat of the year and fix it. You come in front of Hashem on Sunday night. Look, I made a change. I heard the lecture. I listened to the CD. You have a lecture about Shabbat in my CD. If you listen to it, you sit and cry for 1 month. For every Shabbat you broke in your life. People do not know what it means to break Shabbat. If they knew what it means to break Shabbat for $1 billion cash, nobody would agree to break Shabbat. Again, I'm sorry if I spoke a little bit hard, but it's only because I care about you. If I come and tell you how great you are, nothing will change. I had to come like a doctor and told you right now what needs to be fixed. And I hope you're smart enough to grab the CDs. Anyone who wants to take my book, I have a book. It's a treasure of knowledge. If you want, I'll give you my books in English, in Hebrew. I have it right here before I leave. But take the CDs, put it in your car, listen to it. It's going to change your entire life. Thank you very much. Bezrat Hashem, Mazal Tov, and all the best. Thank you.